Valleys People, Episode 5, recorded 24th to 1081, duration 30 minutes, TBA.
Hello and welcome again to the Valleys People. Today we firstly meet a lady who has a job that a lot of people may aspire to. Then again, there are some others that wouldn't want it for the world. It all depends on your personality, and she has a lot of personality. Also, we'll be meeting a man who served the people of the Hunter Valley, and in fact the people of Australia, for over two decades or more. I think you'll find both today's guests interesting, and I hope you can join us. Thanks for joining us today. I wonder how you'd feel about being Lord Mayor's secretary for over 30 years, meeting lots of people, perhaps putting up with a few people too. And that's today's guest, Mrs. Zell Meehan. Welcome to our program of the Valleys People.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you.
You've been one of the notable Valleys People for a number of years.
A million.
might seem that long.
A million.
What's it feel like to be secretary to the Lord Mayor?
Well, it's the same as any other job. It's what you put into it, what you get out.
I guess there have been big formality changes, haven't there, in the position of Lord Mayor?
Oh, a great deal, a great deal. Much pomp and ceremony is gone, and you would never address anyone occupying the office except as my Lord Mayor, never by a Christian name. It's a lot easier in that respect, but the dignity is still there and still has to be observed.
Yes, yeah, that great controversy about what might seem minor things now, like the Lord Mayor's chain and robes of office, and gradually we saw the dignity of Lord Mayor start to manifest itself.
Well, I think the importance too. I think Newcastle's a lot bigger. We're worried with more important issues now. The trivia have really disappeared, and people aren't concerned, you know, with being polite as much as they were, and the formalities, and after all, you want to get there, don't you, in the end?
That's right. Mm. I often ponder to myself those early days of the formality of the Lord Mayor and the Lord Mayoral Ball, and I've got these visions of the Lord Mayor's secretary, you, sifting through would-be debutantes to see who was going to be presented. Is that a problem?
Well, there was a great demand. We had to limit it to 50 girls. I don't think the modern girl would want to be in it to that extent. It was a very exciting time, and I was sad when it ended, but like all things, the era passes. And there were some disappointments, but we managed to accommodate most of them.
I guess some of the modern girls watching today may not even know what we're talking about. The fact that you could be presented to the Lord Mayor of the city. How did the system work, Zell?
Well, we called applications. They were interviewed by me. Then we cut them off. They couldn't be more than 19 years of age. We then went to a series of rehearsals at Mrs. Lambert's studio. Much excitement, much nervousness.
What, rehearsal to curtsy or what?
Oh, yes. Mrs. Lambert was very, very thick on about that. And we usually had the governor. Once we had a governor general or some important dignitary. So it was rather a prestigious event. But like all things, it comes to an end.
But you couldn't win, could you, if you're going to put names through a list of would-be deputants?
Oh, well, you had your own way of doing it.
A nice way, I guess, in your own position.
Right.
One other thing about, we're saying that people of a modern generation may not comprehend what we were talking about. My mind goes back to 1956. I think there were two notable events of 56. One was the Olympic Games, and the other was the controversy about Mrs. Zell Meehan in Newcastle, who was about to be sacked from her position because she dared be married. Or put it the other way, she dared wanted a position after being married.
That's true.
It seems
that,
like light years ago now, that there should be such a raging controversy about that position. I guess you remember it well.
Oh, I certainly do. There was a lot of bitterness and a lot of unhappiness about it. Some people just could not reconcile themselves to the fact that a woman should work after she was married. There really was nothing definite on the council books, although it was contested by the town clerk and he recommended I be suspended. But I won the day, and then following that, they made it universal for all the women. But truly, there were women there when I started at NESCA in 1936 who were married. There was nothing new about it.
So you went through not only the tremors or the traumas of being getting married, but the knowledge that you could be sacked from your position as a consequence of that.
Oh, right, right.
Yeah. And you decided then to fight what you thought was an injustice.
Well, a little bit of stubborn Irish in me. And although I was offered a job outside, the then Lord Mayor did not want me to leave. The town clerk did. And I'm still there.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, you should have the right as an individual to decide. Some people are happier at home, but at the present time, it's almost universal, isn't it?
Yeah, I can only say the case has been won, hasn't it? Historically, the case has been won because it's now accepted.
But, except in Rockhampton, I believe.
Oh, yes, that's right. Well, there are pockets throughout Australia.
Right, yeah.
And it's odd to think that one of the pockets was, in fact, Newcastle
in
those days.
True.
I guess, too, that you've got... you're the person on the other end of the phone. You must get a different type of phone callers all wanting access to the Lord Mayor and you knowing very well that you can't put the calls through, or all of them.
Oh, yes, we do. A Lord Mayor is elected by the people, so therefore should be accessible. But if I can get them talking, I can usually find some way of getting over it. I don't put people off. I never have done that. But if I can give them the answer, they're quite happy. You know, they go on their merry way. And often they just want someone to listen to them.
Yes, I guess that's right, isn't it, when you say there is a fine line? Because, I mean, access is a right after all.
Oh, true. And I don't think any Lord Mayor would deny that.
It's just that you can't give everybody access because you've got other things to do.
That's right. And sometimes, you know, they're really quite trifling things that another department could attend to. And, you know, if I can't do it, well, I can get onto someone who can do it for them. And that's really what they're after.
I don't suppose you ever hear the good about anybody either, do you? They're all complaint calls.
No, we get a few who ring us up and thank us. And they're not as numerous, perhaps, but... it's very gratifying, you know. I've got an old chap who rings me constantly to get the grass cut, you know, around his place and carried away. He cuts it, actually. And then he rings me up to thank me every time. So, although I've never seen him, we're phone friends.
Well, humanity and chivalry is not dead, then.
No, true. Oh,
that's good. How do you overcome what is a natural problem? I suppose it's a problem for any secretary, I mean, dealing with different bosses all the time. One would imagine that you're able, or you should be able, to cope. But... you are, in fact, dealing with a person who's been elevated to a top position in society in an area. And I guess, being the kind of people they are, they all have different personalities. How do you cope working for them all?
They're all different, I can assure you. Male and female, you know, Labour and otherwise. But I find, and I've, you know, this is my theme song, don't panic. The first 3 months are the worst with any new Lord Mayor. You're sizing him up and he's sizing you up. Or she, and after 3 months you settle down. You need a lot of patience, you need a sense of humour. You've got to be very tactful and you never refer to what the previous Lord Mayor did. That just wouldn't be on.
No, that doesn't go over too well, I shouldn't
imagine.
It's like walking the plank, isn't it? Because you can't, you're sizing up the new person in office at the same time as getting the wrath of the people from the community ringing in many occasions.
Oh, yes.
Talking about the community, I think there's one other thing that sticks in my mind a lot. I guess it hasn't been erased from yours either, and that's in the time of the Darwin cyclone. It was over Christmas, and you normally were off, but I've got a picture of you being back in the office there very quickly. And the people of the Hunter Valley rallied to that, like
well,
probably nothing
else. It was tremendous, really, because we just had Christmas, and the Lord Mayor had opened the appeal by air, and I got to the office, and people were queued up waiting to pay money. And
really?
They did not complain about waiting. Two of us took money. We collected over my desk something over $350,000. And that's a lot of money for Newcastle and the Valley.
Indeed. But the other thing that goes with that was the spontaneity of it. I mean, they were almost there before you were.
Oh, they were. They were there when I arrived at the office. I knew they would be.
That's fascinating, isn't it? How do you have time for golf and your other interests?
Oh, well, you only work 6 days a week, you know. I play golf Sunday, I go to the theatre, I'm fond of art exhibitions. I'm a busy person. I have no trouble fitting it in.
Yes, you must be very pleased if you have followed theatre in the Hunter Valley to size
marvellous.
Up its present standing.
It really is marvellous.
I was saying to someone else on the program only recently, you can't really imagine, coming from an earlier generation, how in fact you can decide to go to the theatre in Newcastle on Saturday night, dine at a first-class international restaurant, go to the theatre. I mean, people would have thought you were crazy 30 years ago.
Well, you went to Sydney. Yeah. You just didn't have it here, you know. And that's what I mean by Newcastle growing up. Culturally, you know, educationally, commercially, industrially.
Right. Well, I guess it takes someone with your own special qualities to be in that jump seat where you are. Zell Meehan, thank you very much for coming with us today and telling us about the position of Lord Mayor's Secretary.
Thank you, Ron.
I'll be back in just a moment with our next guest. Thanks for joining us again. Our next guest is Mr. Charles Jones. I don't think anyone's ever called him anything other than Charlie Jones, so I guess I best do that. MHR, a man who's represented the people of Newcastle for well over 25 years, and as well as that, of course, has represented the people of Australia as Minister for Transport. Welcome to the Valley's people.
Thank you, Ron.
I understand you knew our previous guest.
Oh, I think Zell and I might have been associated for a short time. She was my secretary when I was Lord Mayor, and of course we were both young'uns in the Newcastle Council together, she on the as the Lord Mayor's secretary and I as an alderman.
You didn't believe in married women working then though, did you?
Oh, that was an issue in those days. It's no longer an issue.
Yeah.
The funny part about it was that I voted against her and within 12 months she was my secretary. And anyway, from my side of the story, Zell and I got on very well together as Lord Mayor and as Secretary, and we've got on very well since it, and her and Doreen, my wife, we're all good mates.
Yeah, I think that's probably something about both your characters. You're pretty straight people.
She tells you the time of the day.
I remember too as a very young radio man for the major broadcasting network, the sort of days when you had to smuggle tape recorders in the Parliament House in Canberra, and you helped me with a couple of interviews, but I'll never forget that one day I was sort of had an hour or two to spare and I was up
Take it easy.
Well, I was up in the gallery and I looked down and I forget who was speaking at the time, but I heard this expression come from one side, dingo. And then I don't think anybody else heard it, so then I heard it a bit louder, dingo, and I think the third time you looked around for a microphone to yell it into. I can't imagine, or I can't relate, someone who would call someone else a dingo ending up becoming Deputy Speaker of the House of Parliament.
Well, now, first and foremost, your story is not right, because when I interject in the Parliament, they hear it the first time.
You definitely said it three times.
Yeah, that was because I wanted to include it in Hansard. Oh. And unless somebody picks up your interjection, it doesn't go into Hansard. And so that's why, and the Speaker, knowing that, he sometimes lets me get away with murder. Now, okay, how do you become an interjector and the Deputy Speaker of the Parliament?
Right.
Well, as a member of the Parliament, I've got a role to play on behalf of my party to harass the government members, or vice versa, if you're in government, to harass the opposition. And that's the role of a Member of Parliament. And I carry it out to the best of my ability, and I think I do a pretty good job on it. On the matter of me becoming a Deputy Speaker, well, this is the second time I've been a Deputy Speaker. I was a Deputy Speaker in 63, 66, before I went on to the Parliamentary Executive of the party. I'm a Deputy Speaker for the duration of this Parliament. I believe in the institution of Parliament. I believe in democracy. And I believe that we should have one man, one vote, one value. And for the same reason, that because I believe in the institution of Parliament, when I'm in the chair, either as chairman of committees or as Deputy Speaker of the Parliament, I carry out the standing orders of that Parliament in the manner in which they were drafted to be carried out.
So you have a great respect for the institution as such?
I have a great respect for the institution of Parliament, just the same as I have a great respect for the election of local government, of a council.
But if the average kid used a term like dingo, he'd get a clip over the ears, wouldn't he, in the House? What's it mean, anyway, in parliamentary
terms? Well, it's an old Australian saying of somebody who you don't think has got the courage to do the things that they should be doing. And the time I got suspended for calling Phil Lynch a dingo, well, he was a dingo in my opinion. He was squibbing the issue. And the Speaker and I got into halts over it. And
you caught an early plane home.
I got a... To use a term, I got an early bath ticket.
Charlie, as a
sent off.
As a very early man, I guess, we're talking about New South Wales State Dockyard and we're talking about Boilermaker. The information I get back in those days was almost that if you found a nut which wouldn't go on a bolt, you'd be blaming management. You were very much astir in those days. Is that the real picture?
No, in my opinion, I've never been a stirrer. I've been a man of very strong convictions, and when I believed I was right, there was no way that you'd ever get me to back off. And as far as my time as a Boilermakers delegate, which spread over some 17 or 18 years, when I thought my members were right, there was no way that I'd back off. And on the score of management, I had, in some places, I had a very harmonious relationship with management, who at some time or another sacked me. They all came to me for advice from time to time, and that goes from the top man to the junior office boy, if you might as well take the two extremes.
Right. That's fascinating because the picture that emerges that I get looking at or talking to some of those people, they may well be biased, was the fact that you probably spent more time looking for trouble than getting on with the job of boiler making.
I spent more time resolving problems.
Right.
And when you're the president of a shop committee, when you're the Boilermakers senior delegate, when you're an executive member of that union, when you're an alderman of the city, yeah. When you hold practically every top position in the Labor Party structure in Newcastle, well then you tell me how you avoid people coming talking to you. And that, as I repeat, yeah. that included top management.
Yeah, I'm just wondering when you said you never let go, whether that really makes you the expression that you hear in Parliament so often when you talk about Charlie Jones, oh, that obstinate, pig-headed bloke.
You know.
Does that mean you can't?
That was a bloke you said, wasn't it?
Yes, well, for the sake of the show, I'm saying bloke. But does that mean that you just can't compromise? You just really are pig-headed?
No, I'm not pig-headed. I assess a situation. In my industrial negotiations, I assessed what a job was worth. And I don't believe in bartering.
Right.
I don't believe in brinkmanship. In the sense of industrial bartering and relations. For example, when I became minister, up till that point, all of my instrumentalities that I was responsible for, TAA, Qantas, Australian National Line, the National Railways, all these people, when they went into negotiation with the union, they'd put up a ridiculously low level of an offer, you know, a ridiculous offer, an increase of 20 cents or something like that. Yeah, you know, it was stupid. On the other hand, the union used to put in an exorbitant claim that they knew they were never going to get.
Right.
Joe Reardon, who used to be the secretary, federal secretary of the Clerks Union, Joe became the member for Phillip, and Joe and I sat down and talked about it. And Joe agreed with me that we had to cut out brinkmanship and make reasonable offers. And so on one occasion with one of the unions, We drafted with the departmental people, my industrial people in the department, the industrial officer of the airline in question, the private operator, Reg Ansett, and we had a long talk about it and we drafted what we considered was an excellent award. We referred it to a gentleman in the Industrial Commission who said that is a most generous offer. Mm-hmm. What we didn't know was that the union had already made a decision that irrespective of what we offered, they were going to go on strike. And so now the best laid plans of mice and men, etc.
Yes, right.
But it was an attempt, and I think in the long term, everyone learned something from it.
Yes. That sort of summarises some of the things other people say about you.
Well, that's why, you know, when people say I'm pig-headed, obstinate, because I analyse these things in advance and come up with what I consider as the answer.
And you stick with that.
And I stay with it. That's right.
Yes. And people also say that of all the things they could say about Charlie Jones, they can't say anything about his honesty. He always says what he thinks.
Oh, God, yeah. And that also includes honesty in another direction, too.
Right.
The one something I'm very proud of. Yes, I say what I think, because I believe that people in public life should tell the truth. And I have people come and see me today as the federal member, as the minister. I told them the truth, and if it pleased them, that was good, and if it displeased them, that was their worry. Mm. When I was minister, I believed this, that when someone wants to do something, you know, in my case, somebody wanted to build a ship that was going to cost them $30 or $40 million, I don't think you should have them hanging, dangling on the end of a line, waiting for weeks and weeks and weeks. I used to brief myself on it before they came in, and then I'd debate the issue with them.
People still talk about the brawl you had with Reg Ansett, though.
I had a lot of respect for Reg Ansett. Mm-hmm. Reg Ansett, in my opinion, is a great Australian. I think he'd done a great job as far as his airline was concerned.
And pioneering of it, yes.
That's right. We both came from the bottom of the rung. I belonged to a working class family. Reg was the same, and he fought his way up, and we both come up the same way, the tough way. And I had a lot of respect for Reg, and still have. I think he was a great man in the aviation industry. I remember once we were having a brawl, and at about 2 o'clock in the morning, he said, "Charlie, when I came here, I had the crazy idea I was running this airline."
Yes. Yeah.
And I said, "You still are, Reg."
Subject to my influence.
But, oh, well, we were having a little bit of a discussion around a particular matter, but I come back to the point. I think Reg Ansett was a great man in aviation.
There's also something of a commendation of your term as ministry, because I understand that Gough Whitlam said, if not publicly, he certainly said, it's got back to me, that Rex Connor and Charlie Jones were two great ministers in his cabinet. I don't suppose you can comment on that, but I mean, that he did say that, didn't he?
This camera doesn't show me blushing, does it? I know, Gough and I had our differences of opinion, but I think I can say that I'm one of the few ministers in the Whitlam ministry that started as Minister for Transport and finished as Minister for Transport. Mm. And I hope it wasn't because I couldn't do anything else. But Gough is on record. I won't say no more about that. Mm.
You were opposed to the John Kerr appointment as Governor General.
Cabinet had no say in the appointment of Kerr. Gough, after a conclusion of a cabinet meeting one Thursday, said, when you fellows leave here, an announcement will have been made that there's a new Governor General. And of course, everyone said, who? And as soon as he announced Kerr, I hopped up and strongly objected to it. Good boilermaker language.
You had good reason for that, in your
opinion? My word, I had excellent reasons, which were subsequently proven to be correct. And so, I strongly opposed it. And when I took up the opposition to it in Cabinet, other members came in behind me. In my opinion, if the Cabinet had have been given the opportunity of determining who the next Governor General was to have been, I'm confident that Kerr wouldn't have got it.
That you could have swayed the rest of Cabinet with your...
I'm not going to say I would have swayed the rest of the Cabinet, but I reckon I had a pretty good, forceful argument as to why Kerr shouldn't have been appointed, even though his father was a boilermaker.
Yes, well, you know, you've been such a, really, a hard worker. Your wife tells me you're seldom home from meetings before midnight, and you're always, as accessible as any other parliamentarian, particularly as an ex-minister. But you know, you've worked so hard for so many years, 25 years for the people of the Valley in Australia.
Actually, it's 35 years. I've been alderman for 12 years and I've been in this job for 23.
Yeah. Why then would you be philosophically opposed to somebody else who works hard and makes money?
I think you've got to... I'm not philosophically opposed to people just because they make money. I believe that the world is made up of people who, in a rich country such as Australia, the riches and the wealth of this country has got to be made available to all of us. In which, you know, the people on the top rung and the people on the bottom rung. I think the people on the lower income levels today are not getting a fair go. Now, I'm not opposed to people making money. I'm opposed to the inequitable distribution of the wealth of this country.
And why now have you decided to give all this away?
I think you get to a stage where, in any job that you're doing, that you've got to step to one side and allow somebody else to take over. End of this parliament, I'll have had 25 years in the parliament. 25 most interesting years, yes. most constructive. I think that I've made a contribution to this city. I think I've made a contribution to the parliament. I think you get to a stage where you've got to say, right, that's it.
Well, of course, there'll be some viewers who won't agree with that, but I think quite fairly when you think of...
Oh, I don't intend, you know, sitting in the box waiting to screw the lid down. I'll certainly continue to take an interest in community affairs and try and become involved. I've made a point during my term and during my career as a Member of Parliament never to become an executive officer of any other organisation. I believe that my responsibility has been to the Parliament and to the electorate that I represent. Well, now, from my point of view, I'll be looking to possibly become involved with other organisations that can use my experience.
Well, thank you, Charlie, because as being a federal minister and also deputy speaker of the House, it's of credit to the people in the Hunter Valley. And I thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Ron. It was a pleasure.
Well, today, two very interesting people. Firstly, Mrs. Zell Meehan, the secretary to the Lord Mayor of Newcastle, and also Charlie Jones, MHR, who I understand at about 15 years of age went to Canberra once and they sat him in the speaker's chair and somebody tapped him on the head and said, "You might be there one day, sonny." And indeed he was as deputy speaker. I hope you can join us again at the next program of The Valley's People. Goodbye for now.